CNBC Africa's Captains of Industry today would like to put a spotlight on one man's passion to improve the exchange in the East African region. We'll be looking at this man's journey across the different borders in the region in establishing the different exchanges. I'm talking about Robert Mathu, who is the Executive Director at the Capital Markets Authority of Rwanda. Many thanks for making time to speak to us.
Thank you.
This is quite a portfolio, and looking at your profile, you seem like someone who's done quite a bit. Let's start with exactly what you do for the CMA in Rwanda.
Yeah, I'm the executive director of the CMA Rwanda, and I've been running the institution the last going to 7 years. And what do? I provide leadership in terms of putting the capital market structure in place. We started with an institution that was a transitional institution, which was established to help the government of Rwanda come up with a capital market authority. That's one. And then secondly, we were also mandated to propose the legal and regulatory structures.
Right.
Then once the law was published, we had to split the institution into two. The regulatory aspects remained in capital market, now an authority. Previously, it was an advisory council. And the operations side, we pushed to the Rwanda Stock Exchange. So that's how the stock exchange was born.
Mr. Mathu, from 1990, at the NSE in Nairobi and crossing over to establish the NSE, the Securities Exchange in Uganda, how do you describe the exchange or the stock exchange climate in the region?
There are two things. There is the structural setups, and the second thing is investment opportunities.
Right.
And that's the purpose for which these exchanges have been put in place. Now, it's been quite a journey, because the capital market is a market for long-term capital, and we are talking of patient capital.
Right.
It's one thing for, first and foremost, investors, both at household level and institutional level, to first of all appreciate the culture of investing in stocks, in securities for that matter. And the other thing also is being able to plan and mobilize those savings,
right,
and put them in the market. Now, capital markets, I would call it more or less a cultural thing, in the sense that capital markets drive very well where the communities are thrifty and they are used to saving, basically. And then you provide them with an opportunity of trusting somebody else to manage a business where you are not every day.
Right.
Now, we know very well that, looking at the history of Nairobi Stock Exchange per se, it started in the 20s actually, and in 1954 it established itself as a stock exchange, and it was actually, they were given a condition by the London Stock Exchange. So it was like a branch of the London Stock Exchange. So initially, all companies that were listed on the Nairobi Stock Exchange were also listed on the London Stock Exchange.
Right.
But secondly, remember, at that particular time, these were the British. They came to Africa to look for opportunities, and they needed capital. And they knew they had the culture of raising funds for ventures publicly.
Right.
But then soon after independence, a lot of things happened, because we took over the country, and over time, the stock exchanges were not supported as well as they are today. Reason being that we did not adopt the capital market. Our governments did not adopt capital market as an important part of the development of the, and that's why until from 1954 all the way up to 1990, the stock market was not regulated at all.
Right.
Yeah. So it was a free for all.
Let's talk about from 54 coming
now,
to 90s,
yes,
and moving on, what sort of talent was responsible for driving this growth?
Well, just being curious, that is important, and having some kind of a passion in what you're doing.
Right.
It was new, and as I told you, the law in Kenya was passed in 1990, and this is the departure of everything, because once the Capital Market Authority Act, CMA Act, was passed in Kenya, it required that operators in this particular market had
right.
to do business in a particular way.
Right.
And of course, the main driver for establishing or for governments going for even this capital market was actually a push from the World Bank, because many African countries and emerging countries were not doing as well. They were relying purely on debt.
Right.
Many institutions were publicly owned, parastatals. So there was this push to reform the economies. And this was actually, they were called what, structural adjustment programs,
right.
where governments were asked, you have to privatize. And when you privatize, you have to develop your capital market, because capital markets are more transparent. And because of that, the law came into place. The stock exchange was actually asked to enact itself as a business enterprise, as a company, publish its accounts and so forth. The stock brokers had to be licensed, because previously it was just a club of individuals who got together and decided to run the business. The entry and exit rules were a bit opaque at the time. It was difficult, actually. So it was like a trade association, and it's the owners of the business who would decide who comes in and out and so forth. So the law opened this up, required licensing. Business had to operate within certain standards. Now, at the time, when this happened, the rest of East African countries were also looking at the same. But Nairobi, fortunately, already had some basic structures of a capital market. So the authority was born. Tanzania came on board. They also enacted a law. Uganda also decided they have to put a law in place, because this was part of the conditions that were given by the donors.
Right.
So an opportunity came up, mm-hmm. and I found myself in Uganda.
Okay.
Spent a short time helping them to put structures in place. And then as soon as I finished, I also got an opportunity to go to Tanzania. I was invited by Tanzania. So I went there, and I set up the Dar es Salaam Stock Exchange
right.
From scratch. I worked there as a technical advisor. After spending 4 years in Tanzania, I got a stint to South Africa. I was in Johannesburg for some time, and then as soon as we had a new government, first Kibaki's government, there was a lot of enthusiasm,
right.
and I had to travel back home.
Right.
Yeah, I went back to Nairobi. And
Mr. Mathu, you're, so to speak, a Mr. Fix-It when it comes to capital markets. You've been going in the region and helping them set up. And obviously, this involves a lot of translation and communication of vision and the direction where things need to go. What sort of leader would you describe yourself as?
First of all, I lead by doing. And I train people by having them to do the work.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I've always dealt with young people. You go to a place and you find that they can see you have passion. You do it, and you do it with them. After some time, you actually have to get them to do it. They learn by doing.
Right.
And I also take a lot of risks to trust people in terms of working, because it's like someone you're just training them how to drive, and after 100 meters you stop the car and you tell the guy, now here is the key, let's go. So that's you have to take an aspect of that. And luckily, I have come also to discover that, you know, the more you trust young people, the more they become more confident, and I believe in bringing out the best of people, of young people. And I have come also to learn that everyone has their best hidden somewhere inside.
Mm-hmm.
And the most interesting part I like is extracting that best in this in people. So I'll give you examples whereby as we started in all exchanges I have worked up to including here in Rwanda, when it's a new phenomenon. And there are people who will join the organization and they have good qualifications, of course. And what happens is that as you work with them, many of them, most young people, or some of them, it's called predestination. Somebody just tell themselves, I believe I can't be a good speaker. I believe I can do this. And when I observe that, that becomes my focus.
So you have to undo that.
I have to undo that. Right. And I've seen people who would never even speak, stand and speak in front of their own staff. But after some time, we end up even training them how to speak to with confidence. And before you know, the same person is actually out there talking to the media, making presentations and all that. And this has helped because when you are training people to know to do a new business, you need to remove the fear first out of them. And the other thing is that you got to make them know that they can do it, not necessarily exactly like you, but they can also think and be able to do it the way they think is best.
Mr. Mathu, what would you say has been your biggest success in either developing a leader or setting solid structures for these institutions? What would you say, looking back into your vast career, has been your most celebrated success?
I think setting up a whole industry from scratch. You walk into a place, and after a couple of years, you look back, and you see very, very busy people working. And that's what really, I should say, has been my my present to right. myself. Because I'll tell you one time when I went to Tanzania. First of all, capitalism was illegal. You right. remember after the nationalization,
the socialist government.
Exactly.
Yes.
Then later on. Tanzania decided to go the market way. And so they started a stock exchange, and we used to go out and do a lot of public education, just like we do here, because that's the most important thing, to make the public aware of what is going on in the market, how to participate and so forth. Then, in Tanzania, we went somewhere to talk about an IPO which was coming. Mm-hmm. And somebody pulls out and says, has the law changed? It's illegal to own any shares, you know. So that's where you start from. Then you have to explain to these people. Some of them actually used to be employees of the East African, during the East African community. And we managed to make people appreciate about stock exchange. So later on, after I left, a couple of years later, Dar es Salaam Stock Exchange was celebrating a 10-year anniversary. And they invited me. I was already here. They invited me to celebrate with them. So I went to Dar es Salaam. And because of flights, I was a little bit late at the function. And they were in this place where there were, it was like a small trade fair. You know, their booths and all that. So when I walked in, it was so packed with very many young people. And I walk in, and I just went straight to a booth, and I was standing there. And this young lady looks at me, approaches me and says, sir, I would like to introduce you to buying stocks and bonds. So I was listening carefully. And then somebody else who knew me and was expecting me to attend noticed. And he came by and he tried to interrupt. I kept on listening to this young person. And then the lady was told, by the way, he's the one who started this.
He started all this.
Yeah, so I looked around and I was very happy to see brokers, stock exchange staff, custodians, investment bankers. They were all busy trading, and I looked and said, wait a minute, have you ever thought about this? That just by setting up the stock exchange, you created a whole industry with very many people employed, and that's
and that was fulfilling. And now Tanzania, the Dar es Salaam Stock Exchange is a very thriving market.
It is thriving. Right. Last year, they were the best performing. It's the fastest growing today So yes, it is the fast growing in terms of number of IPOs.
Mathu, we'll put a pause there because we'll continue speaking to Robert Mathu, who is the Executive Director of the Capital Markets Authority right here on Captains of Industry. Welcome back. You're watching Captains of Industry right here on CNBC Africa. We're first in business worldwide. Today we're talking to Robert Mathu, who is the Executive Director at the Rwandan Capital Markets Authority, looking at his unique leadership style and the many things he's achieved in his vast career. Robert, it's really intriguing and inspiring to look at that particular journey. But let's start from where it began. You were born and raised in Nairobi, in Kenya. How did this journey that ended up taking you through virtually all the exchanges in the region?
Interesting. I mean, first of all, I was born in Kapenguria, Rift Valley. It's in the North Rift in Kenya. And went to primary there, primary school. And then in 1980, I managed to get a scholarship. My peasant single mother could not afford to pay for my education, so I managed to get to Starehe Boys Center, and that's where the journey began.
Right. Yeah. And obviously Starehe is a home of possibilities.
Yes.
When you look at the region.
Actually, it's called Starehe Boys Center and School, meaning that beyond just academic, it's an institution that prepares men for the world, mm-hmm. And girls now, because we have a Starehe Girls Center also.
Right.
I learned a lot from the school, a very disciplinarian school, and with a lot of extracurricular activity. So we had an opportunity of trying very many things. You know, we did drama, football, scouting.
What did you
swimming.
Try?
I played some very serious soccer.
Okay.
I even played for clubs in Kenya.
All right.
Yeah, but up to university, then work made it difficult to continue. Now, when I left the university, there were no prospects for jobs. So I went and talked to my professor.
There were no prospects for job even in the 80s?
Yes. No, okay. I mean, this was in 1990.
Okay.
When I finished.
So this problem started way back.
Yes. Yeah. Challenging. And what happened is that one day I was working in there was a car manufacturing project. We'll continue to dream. But that's, and I was a salesperson doing research, trying to determine the color of the car that executives would like, and you know, the size and all that. So I was collecting data. Then one day I joined and I went into an office, and there was a young man making photocopies of some papers. So I saw these papers, and I asked him, "What is this about?" He said, "Well, there's a seminar which is going to take place in a few days' time. It's on capital market." But before that, I always had a passion for stock market. I can tell you, when I was at the university, where she began is that I was in second year. I was in first year, and there was a stockbroker. I saw a man come in with a big car and very smartly dressed. So I saw him walk in, and I asked, "Who is that?" He was exceptionally smart, just like you. And he walks in, and someone says, "Well, he's going to give a talk over lunch. He's a stockbroker." So that talk was meant for third year. So I walk in, I sit, listen to him, and I told myself, "I'll be a stockbroker one day." And I walked away.
I want what I'm seeing.
Yes. Right. So because of the way he was talking about money and all that, and I was doing BCom. So when I finished college, I discovered this seminar was going to take place. I went in there and I listened, and then I got the passion. I said, "Now this thing is starting in Kenya. I have to be among the first." And for your information, I was the first employee of Nairobi Stock Exchange in its current form. because wow. previously it was an association of stockbrokers.
Right.
It was registered under the Societies Act.
Yes.
But the brokerage firms themselves were companies and partnerships.
And they owned it for
yes,
up
for all
to
those
very
years.
Recently.
Yeah.
Yes.
So when the government or the law changed to one of the requirements was that they have to register a stock exchange, Nairobi Stock Exchange Limited. So I was doing like an intern there in the beginning. I went to this chairman and I told him, I want you to hire me. And he said, no job. I told him, I'll work for free. He said, no job. I kept going back until he said, OK, sit there. So I became a statistical assistant, just collecting data here and there. And the brokers used to meet. They sit around the table and do what is called an OTC or callover.
Callover. Yes.
And I went there, gave myself the work of administering, collecting data for them.
At no pay.
Yes,
right.
But after a while, I think like a couple of weeks, they said, okay, we're hiring you. And I didn't care about the salary because I was really interested.
It is what you wanted
to do.
It is
what I wanted.
When
I was earning my revenue also on the side doing other things.
When was the first time you invested your money into the market?
In the beginning, I didn't have any money, but after working for, I think, 3 years, that's when I started buying stocks slowly, buy slowly.
And obviously, it has accumulated over time.
Possible.
Let's talk about what was the role of your family in all this, because it involved a lot of traveling, a lot of moving around and setting up in different
yes.
markets, different cultures. What sort of support did you get from your family during this period?
To always be there with me. Luckily, at the time when you are traveling a lot, I was still, young. Mm-hmm. With a young family, it's very easy to travel. But when, the kids have grown and they are
schools,
institutions,
yes.
schools, so it becomes difficult. So, but I'm glad that I got all the support and I still get the support up to now.
Right.
Yes.
What do you do when you're not talking stocks and setting up markets?
I'm reading and discussing with friends mm-hmm. On the industry.
Right.
And I also like watching scientific programs
right.
and channels like National Geographic.
So you totally ditched football?
yeah. I can't play anymore.
Right.
Of course, I also I'm a gym enthusiast. I work out. Mm. And that helps a lot.
How old are you, Mr. Mathu?
I'm 48.
Not retiring anytime soon?
Very soon.
Let's talk about what sort of legacy you'd want to leave for the next generation. There are obviously a lot of younger people who are watching this and they're interested to either invest or just be part of the markets. What message do you have for them?
Well, the message I have is that in the process of wealth creation, there's no path for getting rich quickly. And the focus should always never, to be impatient.
Right.
They have to invest in themselves. They have to study and study and study. Study never ends. Because you can imagine, when you join an industry, some very established industries, they have got structured studies, you have to finish these courses, these levels and so forth. That is what they should do, get professional. Investing in the stock market is for everybody. It's not for those who have studied business, no. It's for literally everybody. Anyone who earns an income should strive to save some money and invest in the market. Why? Because many of enterprises that come to the market are growth enterprises, and some of them have got either dominant market share, they are big corporations, and they will sell products, they will generate revenue, they'll continue to grow, so they become wealthy. If you are not a shareholder, then you are left behind. You can imagine if you had $200, couple of years back, you didn't buy shares of Safaricom at 5. One time they went down to 2. People were disappointed. But today, look where they are, 16, 17. So it's because Safaricom is growing, but it's growing because we are consuming their products.
So young people have to be part of this growth story.
You have to be part of that growth story.
Right.
So as soon as you start earning an income, start buying. And the advantage with the capital market is that you can start very, very small. Very small, but make sure it's consistent when you are investing.
We leave it there.
Yeah.
Many thanks. Robert Mathu is the Executive Director at the Capital Markets Authority. He is this week's Captain of Industry.